evening, everyone. I'll call to order the Arvada City Council workshop for February 13th, 2017. I'm just awfully glad that it's not Valentine's Day so that we can all still enjoy our sweethearts tomorrow night. Okay, Mr. Devin, speaking of sweethearts, you want to talk about economic development?
Thank you. Well, introduce Economic Development Director Ryan Stachelski.
Good evening. I'm just going to go turn on the PowerPoint real quick. Good evening. Thanks for having me. I'd like to also introduce, who will speak in a minute, Katie Press, who's a retail consultant with the city. She's been with the city for about 10 years. And a number of years ago, when the city council asked us to look at different aspects of economic development, her expertise was brought on board because she's worked for the private sector, she's worked for the public sector, and she really has a lot of background in being able to us to connect with a lot of information that would be more difficult for us to get a hold of without her expertise. So Katie will be here in a little while to discuss things, a few items with us. Tonight, what we wanted to talk about, as titled as Economic Development Discussion, and in general, we're talking about financial assistance and other types of incentives that we look at when we're working in economic development. So there are really three things that we wanted to go through in this presentation tonight. And one is, when people talk to us about needing financial assistance, why are they talking to us about financial assistance, and how are they talking to us? What is the process that the city follows, that they come in, they ask us questions, and then they ultimately reach some sort of proposal? How is that proposal modified? Those types of things. Part of that process, it eventually gets to, obviously, City Council, where they're going to discuss whatever that proposal is. And so we want to talk a little bit about the guideposts in which City Council views those. And I use the word guideposts deliberately because it's not the same thing as criteria. Criteria has a more hard and fast line to it that says you're either with the criteria or you're not with the criteria, and guideposts are more of a way to look at things through a certain lens. And so we'll talk a little bit more about that. And then also, we're going to talk about, why are incentives or financial assistance even necessary? What's the environment out there that's causing us to have these conversations? And so those are the three areas that we want to really talk about tonight. Going through the first section, talking about the process in which we sort of receive financial assistance requests. In an ideal world, the way that I think about economic development is that the city is there and it's creating quality of life. It's creating all these different environments in which people can be successful. And so in an ideal world, you really don't want to have to rely or need financial assistance in order to help support the market, get the types of things that your community wants. That's the ideal world. We do a great job with our police. We do a great job with our parks. We do a great job with our roads and all the things that really make our community great. And as a result of that, we're able to attract citizens that want to live here and businesses that want to be in that marketplace that's been created by the environment that is created by the city and those citizens. But I hope that's not me. No, good. What's just is a workshop, so I'm going to go ahead. Sorry. Excuse me for that. Should have done that earlier. We've created that environment, but that environment doesn't always happen. And so people come to us and they said, you know what, we'd really love to be in your city, but for one reason or another, financially it doesn't work for us. Can you help us look at different things? And so before they get to City Council or before they really formalize, we'll sit down with them as staff, and depending on whether it's a primary employer or if it's a retailer employer, we'll kind of work with Katie or others to try to understand what the barriers of investment are. And that's a phrase that I really like to use, because I want to say, what is challenging you to be able to invest in our community? Is it something that you can't find the right land? Can you not find the right building? Is there something wrong with the land? Whatever those barriers are, we try to identify those things and we try to minimize them, and then we also try to look for alternatives. So we work the problem, we try to come up with solutions, and we always, always, always try to find those solutions in a market-driven approach. We want there to be a private sector solution to all these different things. But sometimes you get to a point where you're having the but for conversation. But for some investment by the city, can things be able to continue on? Now, there are instances in which they're going to say, we really want to build in your city, and we're saying, you know what, it might not be the right fit for us. We have other ideas for that land use and those types of things, and then the conversation doesn't go any further. But then there are other times that that conversation is, you know what, maybe this is something that the community may benefit from, and let's continue that conversation. And then that's when we bring it to the policymakers and we ask them, is this something that is worth your consideration for investment in order to make that move forward? And that's when we start balancing the but-for argument, but for this investment, would a development happen? And then we really ask the policymakers again on whether or not they see a community need. So understanding that we've gotten to the parameters that we don't think that this can happen without this investment, is this an appropriate use of resources and policy decisions that is going to help build up a community need? So that's how we think about the process, and we go through several iterations before we get to that final decision, and we try to exhaust all the other possibilities so that we get to this is what's going to need to happen in order to make it work, so that we can bring, again, the policymakers all the decisions that have been sort of previously vetted. So now we get to the next part of it, where it comes to, again, city council to look at it. And what we've tried to say is it's not necessarily up for economic development or staff to establish whether or not there's a true community need. As representatives of the citizens of Arvada and the people that are looking at the best interest of implementing what we'd like to see in our community, we want you guys to be the final decision makers of community need. Now, we've come to this council before and we've asked them several questions related to what are the parameters in general that you use in order to understand whether or not this is a good idea or not a good idea in terms of getting your support. And so this list is not exhaustive, but it does show kind of the spectrum of the different criteria that guideposts that we use in order to really determine if this meets your threshold of wanting to support or not. So in these questions, there are many different perspectives and there are different ways that community need is supported. And when we look at this, and this is articulated more in some of the supporting documents that were provided in the packet, we talk about the idea of needing to meet all of these guideposts or none of the guideposts or some of them. And for each council member, that's really for your mix to understand what the project is and how it relates to that in order to appropriately justify. So at this time, I wanted to bring Katie up as well, because she shares some additional perspective of how these guideposts might be implemented into your decision-making process. And then she'll talk about the environment a little bit as well.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thanks. Good evening.
Hi, Katie.
How are you guys?
Good.
Good.
This is for the next slide, sorry.
Okay, great. Okay, so does the project add primary jobs? That's a question, I think, when we look at primary employment, you see that as being...
What is a primary job? I've never... understood exactly what our definition of a primary job.
Great question. So in the economic world, we determine a primary job is a job that produces more than 50% of its goods or service to go outside of the community. So the idea is that it produces some sort of widget that is exported outside the community to bring new wealth in. So if you look at a service job or a retail job or something like that, it's a job in which that money typically stays in the community. It's spent in the community and then it's respent in the community. It just kind of rotates. A primary job is something like Wonko, for example, that sells its products all over the world, and then they bring new money from all over the world into the city of Arvada in order to increase our wealth. That's how we define primary job.
So, primary job. Does a project add primary jobs? That's a question that you're going to see more times than not related to industries such as Ryan just referenced, which is non-retail. Retail jobs generally are not considered primary jobs because of their salary ranges and by the fact that, as Ryan said, you know, it's really just a service-oriented type of job. It would be an unusual project that could illustrate a meaningful job creation perspective. I mean, and to be really frank with you, out of all the years I've done this, which is a really long time, I've never had primary jobs be a real decision-making factor as it relates to a pure retail incentive. We added it because we know that that's a criteria that gets talked about quite often, but, you know, I've provided a little bit of background for you that, you know, although there are a great number of retailing jobs, they don't really fit into the category of a primary job or something that we would typically incent for just to get. Does the project...
But it certainly would be a factor that we would want to consider if we were looking at an industrial business,
yes,
that wanted to come to town.
Or office.
Or office, something like that.
Yeah. You know, does the project bring unique business to an area of the city? The concept of a unique retailer needs to be expanded to really the concept of unique development. Uniqueness in retailing is less about the retailers themselves, and it's really more about the development concept that they're part of. We see many conventional retailers in conventional types of shopping centers, but we also see a lot of conventional retailers in non-conventional types of shopping centers. And I'd really like to get us to start looking at a more expanded view about what's unique. You know, in all honesty, uniqueness in retailing is less about the retailers themselves and more about the development concept that they're part of. One-of-a-kind retailers are more of an exception than a rule. Matter of fact, we have a nickname for them in our industry. We call them unicorns. They're rare and very difficult to find. Retail development, though, has the ability to be placemaking and unique within the city, regardless of who the retailer makeup is. So we can achieve a lot of things in terms of creating a more unique environment of which more conventional retailers are maybe a part of. So I would really challenge us to have equal focus to creative development concepts as well as those that might actually be unique retailers themselves. Does the project bring goods or services not currently available to an area of the city? This is really one of the easiest guideposts to work with. It's a really straightforward conversation. If an area of the city has services, you know it, and if they don't, you know it as well. Upgrading the retail makeup of an area with better quality retailers can also fit into this category. If we have an area where retailing is lagging, or perhaps we have a retailing complement that is not of a quality that we think is attractive, we have an opportunity to try and regenerate those areas and bring higher quality retailers to the area. Expanding the complement of stores, we may have retailing areas within the city that aren't fully realized, and we want to have the opportunity to expand the retailing concepts in those areas, and I think that would fit well within this guidepost. Well, we may want to introduce a broader cultural offering to meet changing neighborhood needs. This is something that I think we're seeing more and more, and having some fluidity in terms of how we look at bringing goods and services into an area of the city would certainly fit into that category. And all of these factors are worthy of an incentive discussion, in my opinion.
Yeah, Mr. Mary,
can I just ask you a quick question,
yeah,
kind of along those lines? So the what's your view or what I've observed where it's been either poorly developed or poorly planned developed that leaves either, you know, poor access, poor visibility, you know, kind of areas where that maybe are not performing up to the plan. And so when they get, you know, the incentives for the second time around, whether it's to, you know, develop an undeveloped piece of a retail area because it's in an odd spot, or there's, you know, the development is what's made it challenging, but yet it seems like we've seen, you know, incentive requests for those types of things that the only reason the incentive is needed is because of the actions of the developer that has come before it.
You know, there's a lot. I mean, I would tell you in our city, we have a lot of retailing infrastructure that is really reaching a point where it's outdated. And you're going to see as I get into the next section about this, I'm going to talk to you about where I think trends are going to be happening in retail. I think this is a factor that's going to become more and more prominent as consumer choices are changing. I think the conventional format of retailing is likely to start changing. And so they're difficult projects to transition because you have retailing infrastructure on the ground that has to now be accounted for economically. And so they tend to be more economically challenging to actually execute than to go out and build on a raw piece of land. There are certainly challenges with raw pieces of land, but when you really look at taking, I would say, we take any one of our older dated centers in the city and you look at it, there's some level of retailing going on with it, and to actually take that out and reconfigure all of it is a very expensive proposition. And most times that's really where you're going to see some sort of partnership with a public-private partnership that really comes into play, is when we start to see touching existing retailing infrastructure and really trying to transform it to something different. Does the project bring significant sales tax revenue to the city? This is a guidepost that I actually added because, to be honest with you, there are some times, and it's not often, but there are some times where a retail project fits no other category other than it can generate significant sales tax revenue. These are not normal projects. They're usually associated with a very high-profile retailer of a large scale. They're specialty. I mean, they can be an outlet mall. They could be, one of those unicorn retailers that you know, for no other reason than it's competitive. And it's a project that is likely to receive incentives regardless of where it chooses to go, and it has some expectation of it, that we may want to consider this as a guidepost. Obviously, this would have to be some significant sales tax generation.
Right. And David Jones got a question.
And so, the reasoning, let me just finish real quick. The reasoning that you would look at that is, you know, the ability to utilize that sales tax in a worthwhile community benefits really warrants consideration as to whether or not generating a really large number from a sales tax perspective can have some positive community benefits warranting that kind of discussion. I'm sorry.
Yeah, obviously, sales tax is key and critical to our vibrancy. But I'm just curious, in your mind, what does significant look like? Because I know that there have been a few asks, and some have been approved, some haven't been approved, on opportunities that may not, in my mind, be significant.
Right. Significant would be, you know, we already have a Costco, but I would tell you that there's communities who don't have a Costco, and the type of sales volume projections that they could do would warrant for them considerable sales tax incentive motivation. And there's usually an argument as to whether or not a retailer of that scale would even need incentives, but there is some history that incentives are going to be paid to that type of retailer in order to be the beneficiary of the type of sales tax generation that they can do.
So I guess my question on your definition or your idea of significant is a large box retailer like a Costco, as opposed to, say, a restaurant?
Yes. For this category, we're talking about somebody who can get up near $100 million in sales.
Okay.
And it would take a significant retailer of that capacity to get to those, you know, somewhere between $75 and $100 million in sales. This is where, for no other reason, would you consider an incentive, with the exception of the fact that they can generate a significant amount of sales tax to the city.
Thank you.
Bob Pfeiffer.
So interested in that part, but I also think that diversity in the industries would be important too. I mean, granted, a lot of money, but say we go with some big retailer that comes in and things just flop and we put all our eggs in that basket and it doesn't produce. I mean, wouldn't we be interested in finding a cross-section of different tax sources to kind of diversify our revenue?
I think that particular concept is spoken throughout all of these guideposts. You know, when we talk about introducing unique retailing to the city, when we talk about creating services in areas that are underserved, I mean, that is how we are diversifying the sales tax revenue within the city. This is a one-of category in my mind. I mean, I didn't want to exclude it because there is the potential for a project to come to the city that for no other reason than you do it, it can generate $3 million a year in sales tax revenue to the city. So, you know, from my perspective, that this really has only to do with the fact that if you have a project that is, you know, has the ability to really impact the city economics and thereby, you know, enhance the other community benefits, you know, it shouldn't be excluded from consideration of an incentive. And then, does the project create additional public benefit by revitalizing underutilized property? I mean, this kind of crosses over some of the other aspects that we talked about, but absolutely. I mean, you know, retail is a changed environment, and I'm going to spend some time really talking to you about where it's heading because I really think it's in a very dynamic phase. And, you know, I expect this to become a very consistent benchmark for considering incentives going forward. You know, we have perhaps out of date and underutilized shopping centers within the city, and incentives will be a key component of any project that we talk to and how we look at how these centers might start to transition or retail areas. So if all of the guideposts, I think, you know, this will be the one that you will see most often as we start talking about retailing in the future here in the city. Just hit. Sorry, Ryan. So now we're going to talk about some trends in retail. And I think this is going to be the most interesting part of the conversation, because to me, this is a really dynamic place of where retail's going. I want to make sure I have all my notes in front of me the right way. So, I included in some background information, if you guys had a chance to take a look at it, it was a chart about how people spend their extra money. And if you haven't had a chance to take a look at this, this to me in a nutshell kind of encapsulates where retailing, the changes that are happening in retailing. If you'll notice, you're almost midway through that chart before we get to what I would call traditional retail sales, which are things like home electronics, furniture, clothing and those things. If you look at the things that are at the very top of that list, it's dining out, paying off debt, entertainment, a long vacation, short vacation, and food at home for special occasions. So, you know, that's the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Those are the top seven of that chart.
Yeah, I'm not sure we got that chart.
You didn't get this? They
no,
don't have
not,
this?
It's not in one of the three documents.
We didn't
documents.
Do the handouts? They didn't get the retail trends?
It's in it. We can
I
get
did
it
this,
to you.
I
it's
did
in
this
it. It's
whole
in a,
thing for you.
Another packet. They got some other ones, but not that one.
This is like such good stuff.
Okay. We can still talk about
we're
it.
We're going to talk about it. So here's the chart. So we'll make sure you get that. So what this really says is that, you know, there's impacts both cultural, the impacts from both cultural changes of consumers to the expansion of alternative shopping avenues is going to reshape the future of bricks and mortar retailing. All trends are starting to indicate that consumers are moving away from things. I call this the non-materialistic consumer. You know, this is a common response by consumers. They're placing higher value on dining out, entertainment, and vacations. This is a generational perspective. I think everybody felt like originally this was just millennials who were shopping this way, that this is now crossing over. This is coming all the way from the gray hairs, which I qualify as one, all the way back down to the millennials. So this is no longer just one segment of the consumer population. This is a really dynamic shift in expendable dollars. I can't stress about how big of a change this is culturally to retailing. Question is it a lasting impact? It certainly seems like it's going to be. It doesn't seem like this is something that's going to bounce back and we're all of a sudden going to be, you know, interested back in our jewelry and cars and some of those things, but it seems like this is becoming a permanent change in terms of the consumer. Overall, we have a consumer base that's much more conservative with spending. There's a huge placed on value, which is why many of the value retailers have had more success than the non-value retailers in the last few years. There is a ginormous broadening of online shopping.
Ginormous.
Ginormous. 80% of the U.S. population has made an online purchase, regardless of age or economic status. Online is perceived to be more convenient and have a better value. Part of that can be no sales tax. Some of it's the ability to do comparison shopping at your fingertips. The growing question and the growing need of understanding is how do retailers draw customers away from their computers? And I make the statement that if I can sit down with a glass of wine at 10 o'clock at night in front of my computer and the kids are already in bed and it's quiet and I can shop and I can enjoy the experience, how am I going to get you into my store? How am I going to change you from wanting to shop that way? We're very close here in the state of Colorado with Amazon opening a distribution center. We will have same day deliveries. You will be able to purchase the majority of your your health and beauty aids, your paper towels, your dishwasher soap, your laundry soap, and it can be delivered to your door the same day. And if you've seen the commercials, it's not, you know, you can say, Alexa, I need paper towels. Alexa, I need dishwashing soap. And those things will be put on a list and sent to you that same day. So this is going to be a growing, if we have consumers really placing less value on purchasing things, and we have avenues of which they can purchase it in such a way that is much more convenient to them and a better perceived value, to think that we're not going to have a profound impact on bricks and mortar retailing would be foolish. I would tell you there's many in my industry today who feel that the existing amount of retail that sits on the ground today will be in excess of what is needed. Going into the future. So, what is retailing going to do? I mean, they're not going to fold their tents and go home, and there are certainly examples where we're seeing bounce back. Amazon is actually testing bricks and mortar bookstores because they have found that as easy it is to download a book, not everybody likes to read a book on a Kindle. They actually like, or on your iPad. They actually like to have a physical book in their hands. And so now they're seeing a need to bounce back and build a bricks and mortar, complementary bricks and mortar stores that allow them to do book sales. Taking a cue from consumers wanting more experiences, the retail industry is now really starting to focus on the concept of experience to excite customers. So going back to that woman or man sitting at the computer doing their shopping at night, how do I get you to want to come and be part of my shopping environment? And most of this is relating back to you want to have a bit of an experience when you go there. It's an evolving concept. When I say experience, it's going to have a different meaning to every single person in this room. It has a different meaning to me, it has a different meaning to you. And so the challenge for bricks and mortar retailing is how to encapsulate the idea of experience and what you're going to resonate to. We're going to have hits and misses. We're going to have some ideas that are really good, and we're going to have some ideas that totally tank. And I really think, if you look at the history of retailing, every 50 years or so, retailing has undergone some kind of disruption. A reshaping and redefining based on consumer expectations. Last time was right after World War II, and it was the invention and the inception of the strip retail concept. We moved away from downtown retailing and into the idea of strip retailing corridors, and which has manifested itself all the way up to things like large strip centers and things like Superior Marketplace. I will tell you, many in my industry feel that we are now at the inception of a new beginning for retail, and that we are going to go through a massive reshaping and redefining. So we are at that 50-year mark, and we're looking into the future, and what we've done in the past is probably not going to be what we're going to try and do in the future. This is a concept. I mean, if you get online and you really want to read about it, you can find a gazillion articles about what it means to do this, because nobody knows yet. Nobody knows whether, I looked at a really interesting concept out of Albuquerque. It's called Green Jeans Farmery, and it's a little project that's been done all with containers, and it has a coffee store and chef-driven restaurants, and it is wildly successful, and they're looking to try and expand it out to include container housing that is going to complement the container commercial component. We're starting to see many more mixed-use projects starting to have influence, I think, on the design, whether we're going to be retrofitting and looking at older shopping centers that really can't support the amount of square footage that's part of them anymore, and we need to infuse different types of land use concepts in those. I really think we're going to get pushed on some centers to really look at it and say, if it can't be this anymore, what can it be? And because of the size and scale of some of these parcels, it only works potentially for higher density residential housing. So we're starting to see some projects really say, maybe I can't fill that closed Safeway, I need to tear it down, and we're going to do higher density residential on there. So I think it has many ways to go. None are right, none are wrong. There's no formulaic approach to it. One of the things I'll tell you is retail's always been dynamic, and that's really the only certainty we have going forward. So, to say that we need to be fluid, I mean, this ties back to the incentive discussion. I think we need to be, one, we need to be looking forward. I don't think we want to be financially investing in projects that replicate an outdated model. I think we should be looking at what's going to be new and what's going to be interesting and what we think, the residents of Arvada are going to respond positively to, and that may not necessarily be another traditional grocery anchored shopping center. It may need to be much more dynamic than that to kind of fit with the growing perspective of the consumer moving forward. So it's on one hand, the benchmarks that we've just talked about or the guideposts are really good questions for us to be asking, but we need to do it with the idea that retail is on a precipice of dramatic change, and that we need to also be accounting for some of those factors as we look at incentives. Okay, did I go long? I always go long. Questions?
Before we get to questions, too, I mean, you can ask questions, but I also want to close the loop, because retail is one side of the equation, but we also talk about that primary job, primary employer side of the equation, too. What's difficult about the conversation when looking from incentives or financial assistance from a retail standpoint is that the revenue source seems to be a little bit more obvious when you talk about retail. The revenue source is not as obvious when you talk about primary employer. Primary employers bring a lot of benefit, they bring a lot of new wealth to our community, but the challenge is that in the short term, they don't bring a lot of new revenue through traditional revenue sources, i.e. sales tax. Maybe they'll produce some building use tax when they build a new building, maybe they'll bring some use tax when they add some equipment, there'll be some property tax, but when you look at the total property tax that is being generated by a commercial project, a majority of that is going to other entities other than the city of Arvada. So that also makes us need to be more creative with how we look at incentives for those projects. We might need to consider use tax abatements if it's appropriate and it's meeting a community need. We might need to look at building fees. We might need to look at those types of things. And traditionally, we haven't looked at those things, and I think that it's been a very wise policy, so I'm not necessarily advocating for it. What I'm saying is those are the types of things that we would need to consider because it's the only revenue streams we have from those types of projects. So I just wanted to make sure that we're articulating both the retail need for
potentially looking at incentives if it's meeting community need, but there's also balancing that with the primary employers as well. So with that, that concludes our formal remarks, and
great.
We'll take any
Mr.
questions.
Mr. McGough.
Yes, thank you. Yes, I have a question in two separate areas. To follow up on what you're mentioning about primary jobs, I'm just wondering, use an example of one of our businesses in East Arvada. I think one of the things we've talked about with that is just its location, and several of our industrial businesses there, our industries, they import workers. It's primary jobs, but the primary jobs are not ones that have a direct benefit to Arvada in the sense that the people working there also live here and spend their money here. Is that an accurate thing?
So it's a fair point. A portion, however, of those employees would live in Arvada. A portion of that. Number two is that there's an enormous amount of daytime population that's generated by those, so that while they're in the community during the day, they are spending money and those types of things. Number three, those businesses have more ties to other businesses in the community. That business that I mentioned in particular also does business with a handful of other Arvada businesses, and so it's generating a multiplier effect for not just those employees, and it's not just about those jobs, it's also about the other jobs that they touch in order for them to continue their operations, including the retail jobs. So there's the spin-off jobs, there's the multiplier jobs of other manufacturers that they're getting supplies from, and a portion of their employees that live here. So all of these things put together really create kind of an ecosystem that helps build the wealth in the community. It's not just a one kind of one-to-one ratio that way.
Yeah, so when we look at primary jobs, we look at these other kind of sub-factors or sub-guideposts, if you
yes,
will.
Yes, sir, yes.
Because there's lots of other things. Okay, the other question I had, it seems like looking forward, the request for incentives may be somewhat different from what they've been in the past. Primarily in the past, it's been for new construction or scrape and rebuild in some way. Here we're talking about perhaps in the future we're going to have to be looking at our shopping centers, our retail outlets for reconfiguring, and that's where the request for incentives might come in.
Good.
Just reconfigure a shopping center or a strip mall or a strip of shops, et cetera.
Right.
So that will be a difference for us rather than just looking at new construction. Is that kind of an accurate projection of the direction?
Absolutely. So the rebuilding of that real estate infrastructure, whether it's the actual infrastructure, the pipes under the ground, or if it's just the building, are incredibly expensive. And so looking at the rate of return of how long it would take you to scrape a whole retail center and then get that investment back without sizable investments is difficult. For the market to come on and do it on its own, it needs a really positive future. I'm proud to say that one of the centers that did do it on its own and didn't ask for any incentives, although AIDA gave it a little bit of a sign grant, is the Arvada Marketplace. We're seeing a great renaissance with that center, and that's where Sam's Club is located and Hoo Hot and those types of things. So it is possible, but I should also point out that intersection of 52nd and Wadsworth is probably one of the strongest retail intersections in the Denver metro area. It's the confluence of I-70, 76, and Wadsworth Boulevard, which is the second busiest state highway in Colorado. And so when you have 90,000 cars going by it every day, that is a significant driver for customers. But when you get further and further away from that origin, then it becomes more difficult, and so people will have to be asking different questions about how to make the future of their sites worked.
And we'll have to be asking different questions as they come before us.
Absolutely.
Did I understand correctly from Katie Press that it may be that we have as much retail now as we will ever need, given the size of our city?
That seems to be where we're heading. I mean, when you look at Cyber Monday did more sales than Black Friday, outpaced it by a pretty good margin. And you can't take that amount of retailing out of the marketplace and not have some sort of residual impact. So, as we are now searching to buy in a different format than we have in the past, and perhaps we're buying less than we did in the past, our need for retailing infrastructure, I think, is going to dramatically change. This isn't going to happen overnight. I mean, although I will tell you, in what is now a recovered economic dynamic, we're seeing daily announcements of store closures. So, some of these are concept driven. As we seek to be more entertained, in talking to Ryan about this, I mean, when you look at what's happening, like just in the restaurant trade, we like something, but maybe we only like it for 120 days. And then we're kind of bored with the concept. I think one of the things retailing is really wrestling with is this idea of longevity. How do we keep a consumer engaged with us when there's five other hamburger places? And so, these are all of the factors that are really contributing, I think, to what is going to be a very different future going forward. And so, to circle all the way back around and answer your question, I do think that if we look at the infrastructure that's on the ground today, it may be, one, not configured correctly, two, may not be dynamic enough, or three, it's just in plain excess of what was actually going to be needed. And so those pressures are going to get put on industry-wide about what do we do with closed spaces, shopping centers that are struggling, retailers who have shut their doors. What are we going to be doing?
So it may mean for us that if we provide incentives for new construction, mm-hmm. we may just in the future be looking at unused
buildings. I think that really we're going to be looking at a transition. Yeah. I think if it can't be retail anymore, we're going to be looking at what can it be. Mm-hmm. Is it a primary employment opportunity? Is it a residential component? Is it a mixture of all of these things and done in a more dynamic fashion? And each aspect of the industry is going to have to answer that question. The grocers kind of sit over here in one perspective. We have clothing retailing and regional retailing in one perspective, and we have convenience retailing that fits in another, and each perspective is going to have to answer that question for their particular use. I mean, I don't know that the grocery stores need to be 123,000 square foot if I can go buy a bunch of my groceries online. I think that's an interesting question, and one I don't know that everybody is wrestling with yet, in terms of how we start to permanently change our buying habits. I mean, grocery's kind of been one of the last horizons, I think, for online shopping, but that's getting to be much easier and much more attractive than it has been in the past, and I expect that it will get even more attractive as we go forward because, Amazon is definitely going to delve into groceries. Whether you would still buy your bananas from Amazon, you could do a great deal of your non-perishable shopping online and not be impacted, but certainly impacts the scale of what grocery looks like on the ground.
Thank you.
David Jones.
So I've got a couple of questions. We'll start since you're standing there
okay.
at the microphone, Katie.
You bet.
So just kind of following on this conversation of retailing and maybe the future of bricks and mortar retailing concerns me a little bit just thinking about Northwest Arvada, and it's an underdeveloped area. And so looking at the criteria that you gave, does it bring goods or services that, that aren't available to an area? How do you see that looking in Northwest Arvada if retailers are really considering other options?
Well, I mean, most of what we see up in the Northwest is what I call community-based or convenience-level retailing, and it's addressing the needs of the residents in that area. And specifically King Soopers, who's building a new store up at Candelas. Whether or not they, I can't speak to each individual retailer,
right.
whether or not they have actually looked at what the future of retailing looks like and what the impacts are, each has a different answer. So if you look at Kroger in general, they have looked to add a lot of non-grocery related items to their stores to become more of a complete shop for a potential consumer. So, each one of these genres are going to really have to sit down and understand what's next. And You know, the proof is going to be in where people spend their money.
Right. Okay. Well, thank you. It was just when you were talking, I thought, wow.
Build too much already?
Well, yeah. I don't think so.
I don't think so either. I mean, we felt like there was a need up there, and Kroger certainly sees that there's a need up there, and they feel confident that they're going to be meeting those needs. Do I see us having, you know, large regional retail, you know, introduced up there? I think that may be a different question mark, given where some of those retailers are going and how they're viewing, you know, the future of retailing.
Right.
So it may, I think really what will happen is going to influence on where we go from here.
Right.
And, you know, how it starts to transition and becomes, you know, we already hear from the residents up in that area that, you know, they don't have the right kind of restaurants and perhaps they don't have the right kind of retailing, although I think Sprouts is going to be a helpful answer to that. But you're already hearing some of that consumer perspective that they want something slightly different. And so do I expect evolution even though we have certain things on the ground? I do.
Yeah, well, I hear it a lot.
Right.
But that's my job. So just going back real quick, Ryan, to use tax, I'm just curious, and maybe this is a question for Mr. Archer, but the total amount of use tax that the city collects from a primary employer, I'm assuming it's significant, but maybe it's not. No?
So you're asking about general use tax or building use tax?
Just in
general. Building use tax you're only going to get on the actual construction of the project. General use tax is only going to exist when you purchase something that's going to be used inside your business and you don't pay sales tax on it. So you're talking about pretty limited items, possibly desks, computers, those types of things. So in most cases for a primary job, there's not a lot there.
So, you know, the attraction of, let's say, a Smucker's to Arvada, like Longmont got, you know, obviously, you know, there's some other intrinsic value there, but you know, how do we attract, you know, an opportunity like that?
Probably not through incentives. And that wouldn't be the ideal way. So incentives, particularly for a primary job, primary employer, I should say, should probably be like seventh or eighth on the list of reasons why they're making a decision. If it's number one or two on the list, then it's probably not a good fit. One of the things that I like hearing Tom Clark say and others who are involved in the economic development world is that incentives can't make a bad job or a bad deal good. And so those are one of those ideas that there's a reason why they located there. Number one reason people typically locate in areas is access to workforce. So what are their workforce needs? Are they able to get the people to do that? Access is another idea. So, you know, we have some industrial property in West Arvada. And the businesses out there are located out there for specific reasons that are important to them. Maybe it's because they have, maybe they live out there. Maybe it's because they have their workforce out there. But the types of things that are locating off the I-70 corridor in Aurora, for example, that are more distribution-based and those types of things, you know, number one, no disrespect to those businesses, but we don't really want them in West Arvada. We don't want them on our roads. We don't want that kind of truck traffic. They're not close enough for the highway for it to make sense to us. And so that's the way our comp plan looks at those types of things and those type. So we're looking at different types of industry that fits into our smaller market. We have higher land costs just because we're confined because of the amount of land that we have and we're close to the mountains, those types of things. We're only able to build certain size buildings that are kind of a little bit smaller in the market. So those are the types of things that are going to be attracted to our demographics, to our access, to the things that make Arvada have a competitive advantage. And we do have a competitive advantage in some areas, but then we don't have a competitive advantage in other areas that maybe Aurora does or Thornton or those types of things. So when it talks about how are we going to attract those types of employers? What it goes down to is how do we, again, lower those barriers to investment
and then market the heck out of it so everybody knows that our barriers are low, and then it meets their needs. And then hopefully it matches up with some of the target industries that City Council has as part of their strategic results. So that's kind of the thought process that we go through, is that we try to market the easiest path to success for those businesses with the businesses that you guys want to see.
No, and I appreciate that. And I appreciate that a lot, only because, I think, you're right. We want to make sure that whatever businesses are located in here, they fit the profile, I guess, of what council's identified as good industries to target, versus just any and everybody.
Sure.
So thank you.
John Marriott.
So. Fascinating conversation. One is a retailer I have all the time. I want to make just kind of a statement, maybe have you speak to it or a couple of comments about it. In my industry and retailing in general, of course, online sales have changed the world and done it in a pretty short period of time, but yet not completely, because, for instance, in my world, we were probably one of the first industries or market spaces to adopt online retailing, but yet online retailing appears to have kind of started to hit the end of it. And in fact, it appears to me that the winners will be a couple of really big guys in the market space, and then the brick and mortar people who have been able to accommodate or bring online retailing in as part of their product offering or part of their sales channel, as well as industries seem to be adopting some different models rather than just an online retail model or a brick and mortar retail model. There's lots of space in between. I guess it's a way of saying things are going to change probably in ways we don't expect, but I can tell you this as a retailer, what's interesting about the land use part of it, and that's what we're really talking about lots of times for incentives is that, Katie, you mentioned that we have all the retail space we're going to ever need as retailing changes. But yet, as a retailer, I feel like there's not enough space like for someone like us or whatnot. And I think it's more of a mixture, a mix of type of space or type of opportunity out there, and maybe that's part of the conversation for these development incentives are, incentivizing big box retail strip centers maybe isn't the right way to go. It appears to me that that's the loser in this new retailing shift that we've seen over the years is a big box retail is the one that's losing, probably, with the exception of there's going to be a couple big survivors and then some big open spaces. And the trouble with them is if you've incentivized that type of development, those spaces aren't very reusable without redevelopment, which is, of course, an expensive way to do it. So I don't know. I find it interesting. I look at, West Arvada where David lives, and I think it would be incredibly frustrating to live out there, or incredibly frustrating if you're trying to locate a business out there, because your options are so few. Their occupancy in a grocery anchored strip center or nothing are about the only two options there are, and not everybody's market space allows that occupancy of a grocery anchored strip center. I think for us in the city of Arvada, I think we need to acknowledge that there's more than just that, and that as we do our land use planning, and particularly as we look at economic development incentives, to be sure that we don't accept just that this grocery anchored strip center is the only thing out there, because there's lots that are different. I look at businesses like Wheat Ridge Cyclery, which is not a primary employer, but does the city as much good as a primary employer does, because they do large volume for a small business, but that their trade area is the whole metro area. So the bulk of, they're located in Wheat Ridge, but the bulk of the sales, they collect sales tax for the city of Wheat Ridge, But the bulk of the customers are not from Wheat Ridge. I bet not 10% of their customers are from Wheat Ridge. They're from all over the metro area. So they have a great effect of bringing, you know, sales tax dollars into a municipality. And I think there's others like that. But yet, if a Wheat Ridge cyclery were to try to locate in Northwest Arvada, I think they would not find a single opportunity that would allow that, you know. And so I think it's important when we make land use decisions, and particularly when we look at development incentives, to make sure that we keep in mind that there's lots more than just kind of what we see. Anyway, I don't know. They're just rambling thoughts, but
no, I appreciate it. I mean, I think what you really highlight is the challenge that we all face in trying to predict the future and try to be good stewards of both the financial well-being of the city, which is absolutely paramount to our future success, but also be good stewards of the land uses in the city. And balancing those types of equations is very, very difficult, because the land use directly ties into our financial abilities. But inherently there are conflicts in that, and then knowing that what you're doing now is going to be there for 50 years and making sure that you're trying to make the right decision, this is incredibly difficult and complicated stuff. So I appreciate everybody's thoughtfulness in talking about this.
Great. Nancy, you're next.
So there are a lot of thoughts that I have and had while I was reading this. One of the problems that I have with the retail, and you know, it's stated here that the most common jobs in the U.S. Are retail workforce, and I see that as a problem personally, because I look at our home prices here in Arvada, and I can't imagine anyone being able to afford a home on a retail salary. So, to me, that doesn't do the worker, let's say, justice in Arvada, because we're not, that's not really bringing in good jobs that they can then spend. Another thing that I struggle with is, you know, for example, in the news recently, Whole Foods is starting to close some of its less successful stores, despite the fact that we know that a greater percentage of people are buying organic food today. That's a statistic, that's true. And I see the retailer, a larger retailer like Whole Foods, trying to figure it out themselves. And I would struggle very highly to give a retailer financial incentive in a very difficult market today. The other thing that I found very distressing in reading this document was people that are over leveraged. You know, how do we know that a developer or a retail store, for example, isn't over leveraged? And I certainly wouldn't want to give an incentive to someone like that either. The other thing that I wonder about too is, you know, in looking at Arvada, for example, when we have a large retailer come in that we already have in the city, how much more does that retailer add to the sales tax? And that's a statistic that I would really love to know. So for example, I'd be curious to see, okay, let's take Walmart, for example, because that's the one I can think of right now. You know, the store on 72nd and Sheridan, I'd be curious to know what that has brought in terms of sales tax. And now, once the store comes in on Ralston, how will that change? Will that, you know, will it bring in the same percentage of sales tax, or will it be less? And there's that word that I forget, that
cannibalization,
thank you. You know, so that's another area that I struggle with. And honestly,
are we collecting sales tax? That's not in Arvada, is it?
No, it's not in Arvada. That's Westminster. So we're perfectly happy to cannibalize.
Oh, the Walmart on 72nd and Sheridan. Yes, that yes, one's I in Westminster. Those areas are crazy.
Right. Right.
Yeah, I find the whole thing kind of interesting, because the other thing too I've heard in the news is, you know, a lot of stores now are they're trying to develop ways of creating clothing. It's we're kind of going back, you know, we're doing this circle back to custom fit clothing, and where you can, you know, give your measurements online and come up with a garment that fits you perfectly. So I think all these things, you know, technology really is going to change retail. As far as, I see John's store differently than I see a lot of stores, because John's store, for example, he has ski equipment, and that type of a product requires fitting, it requires a lot of knowledge on the salesman or salesperson's part in terms of, you know, being able to express what that equipment's about. But a lot of the things that we buy online today just doesn't require that. And I think in some ways it really is unsustainable to have all these retail stores when it is so simple to go online and purchase and get exactly what you want and not spend a lot of time running around and shopping and driving. And so in a sense, I really do struggle with the whole incentivizing of retail today. There is so much uncertainty, and I would really like to see proof from the financial department of what it really does for the city in terms of, you know, what are the stores that really bring in, you know, I can understand a Costco, you have food there. Food people have to have, we're always gonna sell food. And even if it does sell online, I think people are always gonna have to run for that milk or whatever at the last moment. So I don't think that'll ever go totally online. That would kind of be a little tough. The other thing that I'll just say is, you know, when I've talked to a lot of people, they all mention uniqueness about our old town, that's a real draw, is the uniqueness, and yet we may lose that uniqueness if people cannot afford to have retail in that area. So I'm sort of talking about what you're saying as far as the smaller person that wants to come in and may have, you know, some advantages by having a product that's not available, but you know, because of high rents, they're going to have problems doing that. We do have some issues, tough issues.
Bob Pfeiffer.
So both of you kind of hit where I was going to go. I think that you can tell by just trends, just talking to folks. I think that when you need to get like a charging cable for your phone, people are going to go online. One, that's kind of hard to find in the city. But you don't care about brand, you don't care, you just want the functionality. But something like, well, we're using you, I guess you're getting it. I guess you could, yeah, you could get those out of gas station, but that's not where the first place I think of going to get electronics. Since Radio Shack's not around anymore. But I think with like John, you know, when you have a niche type business where you have to touch, feel, you know, wear, try it on, I think that makes sense. And that's the uniqueness I would look for in a business. I do worry about businesses that sell the same thing that you can get anywhere. That's the ones that I'm afraid won't stay open. Like, I mean, honestly, I worry about Cons. I go by there all the time, and I worry about, you know, are they going to stay open? Because I've gone in there to just see if they're busy or not. But again, you know, you can almost get what they sell anywhere else. So that's my thought about that. The second thing is I applaud that we have people like yourself and our contractors that look over this very hard and difficult recipe, because it's really a recipe for our community, because we want primary jobs, we want higher paying jobs, we want people to be here, but some businesses don't want to be here because maybe we don't have the daytime restaurants, lunch places, shopping environments, things to do outside. So maybe we don't always bring the primary job because we don't have the other environment, but yet we can't get the other environment here if we don't have daytime jobs here. And you know, it's a mix. I always refer to it as making a cake. You got to put all the right ingredients in and you hopefully got a great cake you made in the end of the day. So I mean, I applaud that you guys have the eye on the ball and you're watching for us, and it's definitely a challenge, and we as policymakers need to really focus on giving you the tools, the land zoning and so forth, to make those decisions for the betterment of our community. So I mean, we do what we can, but I think the bubble moves all the time, and I don't think we can predict the future, you know, and I don't know how to fix it. We can't force people to open businesses here, and you know, we will ask. I know you always ask, but we don't always get what we want, so. You don't have to comment. I'm rambling with John over here.
No.
A lot of rambling going on tonight.
Gang. I know, the mayor's over here tapping his foot. It's like, come on, let's go.
The only advice I'd give you is that what attracts businesses to our community are the policies that you lay out to great quality of life. So the parks, all the other things that you do, I mean, that's what's going to attract them here. And so I just want you to keep that in mind, that's just as much of an incentive or more than the financial conversations that we're having, is that the great things that you do for our community.
Well, and that's another interesting element to the ingredients, because it's just like our investment down the road here. You know, we invested in a multi-million dollar park for the floodplain, and that investment has triggered right after that investment across the street in the Ralston Fields area and so forth. And you know, it's just another ingredient, and not always do we have whatever $8-10 million to do those kind of things, but you know, we'll do our best.
Good job.
The city manager will figure it all out.
Right.
I heard a good comment the other day. This is like looking for a lost ball in tall weeds.
Okay, couple quick points, then we'll move on. I am pleased that we as a council have drawn the line at appropriate times. I look at the Sprouts that we did not do a financial incentive, and that's a classic case of taking an obsolete building and getting some new use. I do worry, as Nancy has said, about some cannibalization there. You know, I wonder how that little Walmart grocery store is gonna do when Sprouts comes online. I'm not worried at all about King Soopers. I think they're gonna be fine and dandy. But that's a great example of where we said, no, we're not gonna do a financial incentive, and the market still said this is the right place in the right time. The other one is certainly the Arvada Marketplace. My goodness, and what that speaks to, frankly, was a little bit of a carrot and a stick. You know, when Mark Devin and I go out and chew out the owner of that center and say, you've either got to do something here or we're going to figure out a way that somebody else is going to want to buy it and do it right. And that's exactly what happened, is that someone else came in and bought it and is going to, you know, take something that was outdated, restructured in a way that's going to make it more inviting, more of a place, more of an experience that I think is going to be very successful. So that's very positive. And part of what we've got to look at is not necessarily financial incentives, but putting pressure on where it's appropriate, because I don't want to be the heavy-handed government, but also making things as easy for the development community as possible within, you know, health and safety and other types of factors. But if to the extent we can streamline our processes so that if we've got two City A and City B, we're the more attractive city because we're easier to work with and we can get them online faster, and you know, they're not going to have the headaches that they might have in City B. So those are factors we've got to consider. And remember that when we're talking about financial incentives, we're not talking about writing big checks. We're talking about a sales tax share back, typically on the retail projects, that it's the business that's taking the ultimate risk. They're fronting the dollars, but then we are partnering back in with rebates of sales tax down the road. And some examples where that's worked very well for us is we had a horrible intersection at 64th and Indiana for years, and it was only because of getting the developer to come in who did the original Albertsons complex there, that straightened out that intersection at a tremendous cost and then received refunding of money. And frankly, you know, there was a time where they may not have gotten it all back, but they're the ones who took the risk on that, not us. So I'm pleased with the guideposts. I'm not hearing anybody not liking the guideposts. So Mr. Devin, does that give you sufficient direction? Obviously, we all agree we don't have a crystal ball. I've had a lot of conversation with other retailers, but I think the niche retailers, I mean, when you got Scott Spears is going to put in a little sock store in Old Town Arvada, that just warms my heart, because it's the specialty things like that that are going to be successful and create the uniqueness that makes Arvada so very special. So keep up the good work.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you. Good.
You want to stretch?
Yes, we can stretch. Here we're, okay, we now have 20 minutes left for our last two presentations.
I can do mine pretty quick. Thank you, Ryan. Okay, you're up. You know that the mayor's not going to lodge much time. No, you got all you need. Thank you.
Linda Haley, I'm going to give you as much time as you need it, and then Mr. McGough's presentation will just get whatever fraction of time is left. So.
Thank you, Mayor. I appreciate that. Are we ready?
We are.
Okay. Well, thank you for the opportunity to discuss total compensation with you all. I also want to make sure I introduce Gabriella in the back. She's here to provide not only the moral support, but she's truly the expert in compensation. And if there are some questions that I might not be able to answer, we'll shoot to Gabriella to hopefully answer it. I want to remind you all that as we get started, in your packets, we did give you a pretty comprehensive report on total compensation. Hopefully you've had a chance to read through that. That is Gabriella's work, and I think a very good picture of what it is we strive to do here at the City of Arvada when we establish pay and benefits for our employees. What I want to do this evening is give you a high-level overview of that report, give you a bit of a history of our total compensation philosophy and where we are today, get into shining the light a little bit on our market, trying to define for you what that market means, the difference between public market and private sector market, and how we design our practices around pay and benefits using that market data. And then, of course, questions that you may have that we may not be able to answer this evening, I would ask that you give us a chance to follow up as needed, and we'll work on that appropriately for you, okay? All right, so with that, brief history on the total compensation philosophy. From what Gabrielle and I could gather, this is before our time here at the city, but we do know that there's been at least 20 years of market-based type of salary and benefit setting. Back in 1997, the understanding is it was market-based based on public and private sector data in the Denver-Boulder area. In 2004, the understanding was the philosophy for the approach for the City of Arvada is to be among the leaders in the front range. And there were 14 different local governments that were used as comparison data, primarily over others. Then in 2011, with the help of City Council, it was about a year-long process, and a couple of you were on that council, we went through a study to update our philosophy, really looking at becoming what we are now calling ourselves as an employer of choice, striving to be competitive, not the leaders in pay or benefits by any means, but really competitive and truly focusing on who our primary competitors are to find the right people to be successful in this organization and, of course, for the community. Obviously, with the guideposts and the foundational priorities of ensuring that we always are fiscally responsible when we develop our pay plan and our benefit strategy, and we fund it within the city's ability, okay? So employer of choice, what we expect, obviously we want to have high performing employees. We need employees with knowledge, experience, and skills. Many of our jobs require that coming into the door. Even some of our entry-level positions do require a certain level of education or skill set or the ability to acquire skills at a certifiable level, lots of certifications within the city. So in exchange for those kinds of skills that we really need for our employees, we want to make sure that we're providing competitive pay and benefits. We want a professional development, and that's what we strive to provide. When we want our employees to be very dedicated to performance excellence and meet and exceed our customer expectations, we want to ensure that as an employer, we continue to allow them to grow and develop, have a great culture and environment in which to work, and have meaningful work to do so that they stay. So how have we been doing with that employer of choice philosophy? We feel we've been doing pretty well, and we have a couple of data points that are evidence of that. Back in 2012 and 2015, we did receive the Top Workplaces Award. That was a survey that we participated in those 2 years with tremendous response from our employees, and overall results did indicate that they're satisfied with pay and benefits, the training opportunities they have, the ability to have work-life balance and meaningful works, along with relationships and feeling supported by their managers. So, using that employer of choice philosophy and trying to shine a little bit of light on our market and how we compare to the market for you. Our primary market is the public sector. We compare ourselves to local government employers throughout the Denver-Boulder area. We also do use some private sector data, but it is limited. The data that we pull from is from survey data from, for example, Mountain States Employers Council. It's credible, it's valid data, it's comprehensive data. The private sector data that is used is limited, however, because it's only by those employers that choose to participate in the surveys. The advantage we have in the public sector is all public sector employers participate in the survey because this is public data. As an employer, it's great to be able to share that data with our competitors and know exactly where we are. And of course, they're our primary source of competition, so it's nice that we have that information easily accessible. The private sector is a little bit different. Yes, we do have access to some survey data, but it really is dependent on those employers that choose to participate in the surveys. So we have to make sure that that distinction is clear, and that data from the private sector is blended with the public sector data that we have in these surveys that we receive. So kind of the apples to oranges, why we do compare to the private sector and also why we don't. Again, as I mentioned, salary information, when it's available, is absolutely helpful and useful. But I'll show you in a few more slides moving forward where we kind of draw the line and use it more of for informational purposes than true targeted type of private sector information. When you look at the private sector for benefits, that's a whole different animal than salaries. There are a lot of different variables in place that are extremes in some cases. Again, private sector data for benefits is not as accessible as public sector data either. But as I'll tell you in the next couple slides, there are the reasons why we don't use private sector data for our benefits. So, digging a little bit deeper into pay and what we do to establish pay. It is market-based, mostly public sector data with some private. As I mentioned, our data that we use is with employers in the Denver-Boulder area. We compare pay to the average of actual pay in the market. So there are some employers in the survey data that we use that pay more. There are some that pay less. We compare to the actual average of all that pay. And that's where we develop our market and how we establish the market pay for the jobs that we have. When I talk about private sector and public sector data. There are some jobs at the city of Arvada that do exist in the private sector, so there is some salary information available on those jobs. About 36% of the jobs are compared to both public and private sector. That represents about a quarter of our employees, and that's because you see the differences in the percentages is because we have multiple incumbent employees working in the same job. An obvious example would be a police officer. So about a quarter of the employees have jobs that can be found in the private sector, and that's about 36% of the jobs that we have. Okay. So how do we compare? I pulled a few charts. I believe this comes straight from the packet that you received. And then I'll show you a different one that we added to this as well. To give you some distinction, what you see on those graphs are the actual job families that we have in our pay plan here at the city. Executive job family is comprised of executive level jobs such as department heads. The INFT stands for information technology. Those are all the information technology jobs. And down the line, LTCU is labor trades, crafts, and utilities. Then we have all management positions in one job family, all PD positions in one job family, professional, and then TBS is technical and business support. So Arvada's average salaries for those job families are on the blue bar graphs that you see, and that is compared to the market average salaries in the orange. As you can see, fairly close throughout. Okay, and taking it a little bit further, this next graph shows you more details about specific jobs. As I mentioned, we have some jobs in the private sector, so we put a list up there for you that have, we know that these are jobs you can also find in the private sector, okay? And these are the average salaries for each of those jobs. Again, Arvada's salary is the blue graph, and then the combined market average for public and private is the orange, and then public sector only average salaries is the green. As you can see, again, not a whole lot of variance there at all. And this tells you that, again, our primary source of data and the primary information that we use is public sector, because that's the majority of the data that we can receive. Yes, there is some private sector data in there, but it's not a lot, and it's blended with the public sector data. So that's why you see the graphs the way you do and how similar that they are.
Okay, Bob Pfeiffer.
Do you have, this is just a sample, right? You just
yes.
Randomly picked.
Okay. Yes.
I would be curious how many are like on the right, because the one on the far right, it's a technical job. And to me, there's more variances. And do we have a lot of that, or did we just conveniently find ones that are very flat lined across? And only found one that was
sure.
A little out of whack.
Sure.
Because, I mean, even the private sector is higher than us by 10% almost.
Mm-hmm.
Or no, more than 10%.
Mm-hmm.
Or the public sector is, so.
Sure.
Did you do that across the board on all of the ones you can, or just these?
These are just a sample of jobs found in both public and private sector. They were picked randomly out of the group of jobs that are found in both. I think that we could do that for all of the private sector jobs. It's just that we would be manipulating our matches to get the public sector only. So we can certainly do that. It would just be a little bit administrative.
Well, I'm just curious how many are out of whack like that?
Are these truly representative, I think, is the question.
Yes, because as Linda mentioned, the private public mix is blended, so you don't see a lot of discrepancy. Informational technology jobs do tend to be paid higher in the public sector, and in that particular example, we actually don't have a lot of public sector matches to make to that job. So in this case, the private sector brings in more data for us.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Okay.
Nancy?
When we're comparing jobs, excuse me, so in Arvada, where I'm assuming, and I hope this is a correct assumption, that the tenure of our employees is generally higher than other cities. So wouldn't the fact that they're here longer, Well, maybe not, though, because if they're here longer, chances are, I'm answering my own question. And well, because
are you arguing with yourself too?
Yeah,
that's really got me a little bit worried here, Nancy.
You like this conversation? You like this conversation? Well, you know why? Because I'm looking at the bars, and I'm thinking to myself, well, are there certain jobs where we have lower tenure, and so it would, in comparing the salaries, it would be less than, say, you know, on average, than say, in the thing, then say the people who. The thing that struck me
I'd
was.
I'd love to see you in a courtroom, Nancy. I just, in front of a judge, I would just pay for that.
It would drive the judge
nuts.
Yes,
it would.
Wouldn't it? Because I was looking at the executive, for example, and the management, you know. And so I found it interesting that, you know, looking at the executive in Arvada, it was, the bar was a little lower. Mm-hmm. You know, the amount was a little lower than with the management. And so I was wondering if tenure affects comparison, is really the question that I'm asking. Does it affect comparison? Because you have to weigh those, don't you?
Because it's so market driven, the priority is the average of what the market is paying currently. And so we adjust our pay plan every year to ensure that we're following the market. And so yes, while there might be some indication that tenure could be a part of that, it's not a huge part of it, no, because we're looking at current market data every year to continue to update and establish the pay plan. Because of our structure, we do have people that are tenured, been here more than 10 years, beyond the 12 years in the step system that we have, and they're at the very, very top. But that's only after 12 years of employment. And so if market changes, the market rate for that at the top end will either stay stagnant or maybe go up a little bit. But it's not a tremendous impact on the overall establishment of average salary information in the market every year. And I think Gabriella wanted to add something too, if you don't mind.
I just wanted to add that we also do look at data for pay ranges. So if the average pay is skewed a bit because of tenure type situations where, let's say, a higher tenured typical job like a police officer might have a higher average, but we also look at the range to make sure we're not overstepping or creating maximums that are higher based on average data. So we use the range data to make sure our ranges are well within the market. And that's actually illustrated in the report, in the example on page, let's see. Page 4 shows you how we actually look at all of that information to make sure we're putting things in the right place.
And this is just salary, so mm-hmm. So in our situation where someone reaches that highest point, then we tend to compensate with days off or other types, whereas the private market will continue to increase salary, won't they?
Perhaps, Nancy. Yeah, it's a great point to make. Salary growth, when you reach the top level of that, you know, what the market pays for that particular job, then you're there. So what are some other ways that we can incent the employee to stay? And is it in the form of, you know, recognition, time off, those kinds of things? Private sector, it's hard to say how they manage that. But yes, they have more flexibility in creating different pay methods, for sure.
You would think. Not always.
Yeah. Ms. Marriott.
A couple just quick questions. So with this type of a philosophy of how you determine what the pay range ought to be or the pay for a certain job mm-hmm. would be, how do you avoid just the endless ratcheting effect of anytime anybody in the public sector bumps theirs to get to average, mm-hmm. that just moved the average up, which means we're up for the next bump to get to the average, which mm-hmm. moved the average up, and so the next group bumps to get, and you know, it's this mm-hmm. endless kind of ratcheting upward effect. Is mm-hmm. there anything within kind of your formula or the way you look at that to kind of take that into account?
Absolutely. I mean, we do our tenure modeling to ensure that we continue within our own city's ability to fund, that we're being strategic about how we're looking at market increases and planning accordingly for that. If we see rapid jumps in the market in a given year, John, we may not necessarily react to that because it could be indicative of something very temporarily happening. You know, is there an influx of need for something? But it's not going to be the same kind of need even a year later. So we monitor the jobs very routinely and on an ongoing yearly basis. If we see some market changes in particular jobs that we haven't seen trending for what we feel is at least a couple years, then we may not do anything to make changes to that pay. That's not to say we haven't been able to react quickly if we need to as well. You know, there's competition out there in the public sector, as we all know, and if we're not on top of that and being able to react in the way that we can, quickly but also strategically, it's a delicate balancing act. But yes, we do work on that, absolutely.
Okay, so let me ask a second question. The second question would be, out in the private sector, of course, labor is a market-driven force, and labor rates go up, but sometimes they go down given the supply and demand. Within your model, is there any, or within your methodology for looking at paid things, is there any room for wages to ever go down?
Yes.
So as market forces changes, a certain position might be a surplus of labor available in the market, and it's possible that those,
absolutely.
That those pay ranges
absolutely.
Might go down.
Absolutely. Not so many years ago, there was the big demand for IT positions, paying top dollar for those positions, and the ability to try to compete with that and create salaries that would attract someone was very, very hard. And then the market just kind of bottomed out on that, and things just went cold for a while. And we react to that as well. Okay. Yes, absolutely.
Change the salary range
if jobs
of a certain
have
job,
to
yeah.
go down as a result of market, we absolutely do that.
Okay, and then last question would be, it kind of strikes me as, you know, a clerk type function position that I'm sure the city has. I think of when I pay water bills, you know, there's great clerks that mm-hmm. that do that. But, you know, how would that type of a position in both wages and benefits compare with a private sector type of a clerk position? It seems like that our positions are in those lower ranges, whether it's a clerk position or a landscape worker, you know, one of our parks workers or something like that, mm-hmm. are probably compensated, I would guess, fairly much higher than the private sector is, particularly if you take into account benefits, of which there generally aren't any in the private sector or mm-hmm. or very limited.
Mm-hmm. Perhaps. And Gabriella, can you speak to that a little bit?
So for jobs like that do have private sector equivalents, we are bringing in the private sector data for information. So we do see in some instances, like a administrative assistant or a clerk, like you mentioned, or even a custodian, where maybe the government tends to pay higher, but the private sector doesn't. By bringing in that private sector data, we're balancing out that effect when right. we decide to grade the jobs.
And are benefits considered as well? Because I guess I'm thinking of like a bank teller, for instance. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, bank tellers perform a similar clerical type function, but mm-hmm. I suspect, I don't know, but I, given the turnover you see in most bank teller positions, I don't think they're paid real high, and mm-hmm. I suspect they get little to no benefits, you know, and mm-hmm. I believe our employees probably do, and I'm not suggesting that we change any of that, but it's mm-hmm. more how does your methodology, you know, look at that as a competitive situation and account for that?
Well, again, we try to get into the details of what the job requires. And there may be similarities between a bank teller and a utility technician, but there may be a lot of differences too. And so that's why the data we use from the Colorado Municipal League, from Mountain States Employers Council, is to try to find and truly match the content and level of skills and experience needed for that job in order to place it correctly in the market. So it's again, trying to compare and making true comparisons to the actual work being done and skills required. Because you can make those kind of comparisons all over the place, but without really doing some analysis and data research to justify where you're putting it in the market, it just won't work, so.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Don Howard.
You don't actually decrease the starting and top part of the salary, do you? Mm-hmm. When in the usual customary thing of all cities that when a job decreases in pay, you simply freeze it?
That's right.
Okay, and do these colors, is that the middle of the pay range, or is that?
That's the middle of the pay range.
And that's compared, a lot of private firms don't have ranges.
Right.
So you just go by their number.
It's their average salary based on the
survey.
And
you compare their number with our average, which is?
The middle of our range.
Not the average, but it's the middle of the range.
Right.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay, you can continue on with your presentation.
All right, on to benefits. So why do we match only to the public sector? For us, again, because 75% of our employees are in jobs that are only found in the public sector, it's a truer, more valid match to use data from the public sector for our benefits. And again, because benefits is such a different type of animal, when you look at it from an employer's perspective, we have data available to us from other public sector employers that can give us information about costs, co-pays, plan designs. You can't really easily get that type of data from the private sector. Yes, we have survey data again, but it's only from those private sector employers that choose to participate, and it's general information.
But aren't those typically large employers?
We try.
We're a large corporation at the
mm-hmm.
city of Arvada.
Mm-hmm.
It seems to me we ought to be able to compare to large companies mm-hmm. that do report to Mountain States.
Mm-hmm.
Are we getting that information?
We're getting general information, but again, there is, depending on provider for the healthcare, depending on overall demographics of the employee population, depending on plan design for what's provided, they may have, no spouse or dependent coverage at all. Mm-hmm. Employees have great care, fully paid for, but you cannot cover your spouse or dependents.
Or there's a penalty for your spouse.
Or there's a penalty.
That's what we pay as a penalty.
Yeah, we can't access that data. I mean, we could maybe try to mine for it a little bit further, but what we get in the survey data that we rely upon, because we know that it's validated and it comes from a valid source, is the general costs, the overall types of trends. If we see double-digit increases in premiums, we can get that data. But did we see that they moved from Cigna to Kaiser? No. Did we see that, the employer pays so much towards the benefits, but it's up to the employee to pay the rest? We don't get that as easily from the private sector. We get that very easily from the public sector. And because they're our main source of competition, because 64% of the jobs that are here are public sector only, it makes sense for us, we feel, with our strategy, to use public sector data for benefits.
Here's the rub that I've had for decades, is that traditionally, public sector employees were not paid as well as private sector employees. That for years and years and years, you look at, and you still see it in like the school district and some other areas. And so the mentality for decades has been that, well, because public sector employees don't make as much money, we're going to treat them better in the benefit package
mm-hmm.
side. I mean, that was sort of the thought process, mm-hmm. and that's my Chamber of Commerce days, and so I have a lot of bias that comes into this. Over the years, I think Arvada's done a darn good job of getting the pays up comparable to the private sector, and yet the benefit package has remained much better than the private sector. That's the perception, and that's why I'm asking for as much information,
mm-hmm.
and I'm not expecting it tonight, but
sure.
I'm expecting and would like to see more information of how do we compare to large companies. Mm-hmm. You know, because I understand mom and pops aren't going to have good benefit packages. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, that's just the nature of, you know, how tight it is for mom and pop operations. But for major companies, you know, I still believe that our benefit packages in the public sector overall mm-hmm. are much better than they are in the private sector. And so if we've got this desire to get the pay at the same level with the private sector, maybe the benefits have to come down some. I mean, that's the bias that I'm bringing into this equation.
Well, I appreciate the feedback, Mayor. I would argue, though, that we aren't on par with private sector pay in many respects.
Okay.
Because we can't. We use some base pay data, very limited data, blended with public sector data to establish our pay. That does not include bonuses, profit sharing, other types of incentives that private sector companies can and do
and
provide.
And that would be useful information.
And large companies do provide.
That would be useful information for me to analyze that.
Absolutely. And we will be happy to follow up. I'd like to just make the statement that we still strive to provide a comprehensive benefits package because we do not compare to private sector.
Sure, and I get that. And sorry, I'm sort of tagging on with what John Marriott's talking about this ratchet, you know, that the public sector has this sort of monopoly of being able to move up salaries by comparing to each other and doing the same thing with benefits. And I think we've got to at least look at the private sector in terms of how it fits into it, because frankly, so much of the government funding comes from the private sector that there ought to be some correlation. But I'll get off my soapbox for now anyway. David, you're next.
Yeah, appreciate it.
Well, appreciate me getting off the soapbox.
No. Feedback.
Yes, we all do.
Appreciate the feedback.
May I address the mayor for a second?
Sure.
Hi, Mark. I just wanted to say that when we do adjust our ranges, we are looking at national trends, market, private, public. We're not looking at just the public sector. So when we bring to you a recommendation to adjust a range by or a family by 2%, we're usually looking at the averages overall in both the region but also in national, which does take into account the private sector. So I hope that helps, but we can.
My only concern with your presentation is that I hear you're relying upon CML information, and it's such a questionable organization.
Only 10%.
Okay.
So, kind of following along talking about the benefits section, of the cities that are listed here, and correct me if I'm wrong, but City of Arvada is self-funded from a health insurance mm-hmm. perspective. Mm-hmm. Are
all you on the next slide?
I'm on how do we compare health insurance premiums. Trying to keep us going here.
You bet.
Yeah, since the mayor is really messed up tonight, yeah, go ahead.
But so are all of those cities all also self-funded?
Because no, I think they're not.
Because I think that, you know, that's a big deal. And so kind of, you know, to the mayor's point on benefits, you know, having a self-funded program, sometimes you have more latitude, sometimes you don't. Depending upon your claims history. However,
right.
My experience has been that, you know, self-funded programs often create a situation where you can offer lower entry for an employee or a family to come in with better benefits. It's kind of all over the board. But I guess my question is, you know, how do we compare to those cities that are self-funded versus those that are funded from a completely underwritten perspective?
Sure. I mean, we can pull some of that data for you as well. It's hard for me to differentiate who's self-funded and who's not from this chart, but you know, to your point, just in the last 3 years since we've gone to a self-funded health plan, having more control, more say in how we're establishing the plan for the employees has been tremendously helpful.
Well, and I think the other thing that you have to, you know, take into consideration is, you know, the city goes to a great extent to ensure that employees are taking advantage of the healthy programs.
Right.
You know, and so those healthy programs, you know, the mammogram van that shows up, you know, is that helping to detect, you know, those kinds of situations sooner than it would in the private sector?
Yes.
Absolutely. So yes. Anyway, I think that there's a lot of points to consider that maybe aren't even on the graph here.
Very true. Good point.
That's why this is the first discussion of all this. I'm sure we'll have many more.
Every month. I'm just kidding.
Bob Pfeiffer.
I know you're not done with your presentation, but
no,
you're almost to the end.
Mm-hmm.
You know what? I will wait until you get through. Because we should probably get through this, and then we can recap some of this.
Great.
So I'll wait till the end.
Thank you.
So we went through this. This is just, again, our comparison of what we pay as an employer compared to our fellow local governments in the area. Arvada's is the first blue line, as you can see. We have single coverage, employee plus one, and family coverage. And then to dig a little deeper into that, we do have the differences in how we cost share. So the employer's share of premiums by coverage type, meaning what the employer, Arvada, pays and what the employee themselves pays. We have an 80-20 split for single coverage. For employee plus one, it's a 78-22 split. And for family coverage, it's a 77-23 split. As you can see, we're the lowest in that chart. Having our employees share the cost of the premiums is also incentive to help them and encourage better use of their health plan. It's you know, I use incentive probably in the wrong word, but we went through this with City Council, if you recall, a few years ago. We were 80-20 across the board, and when we were looking at ways to better utilize the plan, have the dependents and a lot of family coverage, pay a little bit more of the costs of coverage, and moving to self-funded, bringing Paladina on board, we felt that all of these changes have been contributing really well to us being able to manage the costs, where in the past we were seeing double-digit increases in premiums, and we've been much lower these past 3 years. So, but we show you this, as you can see, just for comparison purposes. And then finally, with our next steps, as we said at the beginning of this presentation, it's in our best interest and as a best practice that we look at our total compensation philosophy every 5 to 7 years, and we're at that point now. We're 5 years into the current philosophy. So we would like to invite council into a discussion beginning in 2018 to formally look at the total compensation philosophy once again, moving forward with, you know, focus with our new vision, mission, values, with the culture we're establishing and strategic priorities that we want to achieve. Are we using a philosophy that will meet all of those demands? And so that's why it's in our best interest to constantly look at this and work with you for guidance in this next year. So that's what we'd like to do. Now we're to questions.
Very good. Mr. Pfeiffer.
All right, so first thing, just to clarify, somebody said, does corporations have pay ranges? Yes, they do. They may not say it, but a lot of corporations do use actually government pay ranges. It's funny, but we actually use the G codes from the U.S. government, my employer, to put people in those ranges. Now, the funny part is the employees don't know they're in ranges. I guess we don't communicate.
More transparency in government.
Yeah, well, we're a privately held company. I guess it's a little bit different.
Yep, Now,
the only thing I had in with the pay ranges that I do struggle here at the city is how frequently we change them. I think that's what you're probably starting to hear. I think in the private corporate America I've been accustomed to, those ranges don't change every year. They're usually set for a few years and then reevaluated and set for a few, three more years, reevaluated. I think that that might be something we might want to consider. I don't think we need to do it every year like we have been. The second thing is, what retention tools do we have when we're trying to retain an employee? I thought I was hearing it, but then I didn't hear it. Do we have retention tools?
Well, we certainly work on the training and development aspects for the employees, the opportunities for work-life balance, talking about healthcare and wellness opportunities to do stretch assignments, We'll be coming back to you later in this year about workforce planning and succession planning and how are we grooming employees now. All of that is our ways to retain employees.
Hey, do you get exit surveys done
mm-hmm.
with employees? Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I'm sure you get some hopefully valuable and transparent feedback
from
the exit.
Okay. Absolutely.
Everybody that leaves because they get sick and tired of city council. It's our fault.
It's on Mondays, I've noticed, or Tuesday mornings. And then the third thing, I'm just totally going to be honest here on this, and not that I'm not ever, but the benefits fall short. I'm going to tell you, I'm opposite of the mayor on this. You know what? I'll tell you. Here's why. Let me explain why. One, I don't pay $1,500 a month for my family. I pay $400. And I have 3,000 employees in my business. But I know it. But I get that. But there's so much out there that we're self-funding. And why I think we fell short is because I was under the belief we were not the highest in the premium charges. And when you go back to that chart on the premium charges, as a family, we're the highest in the ones we compared to. And then what gets me a little crazy is yet we take the biggest savings off of it as the employer. And that drives me crazy.
Mr. Pfeiffer, I just want to clarify, the chart reflects the city's cost, not the employee's.
The 77%.
Yeah, but the 1500 is what the city pays. The employee pays more like 500.
So the employer's health premium, so the 1500 is us?
Yes.
Okay, all right, thank you. I was taking that wrong. I was like, okay, not
thank
necessarily
you.
In the mayor's camp,
thank
but
you
I was getting a little worried that that's what the employee was paying for.
Mr. Marriott, never going to take you out back.
Well, hey, I've had this whole thing about the benefits, always trying to keep those premiums flatlined if all possible and across the board, and I think we've been doing that. So now that that chart's been explained further for me, I'm not so panicky about it.
Thank
when
you,
I first
Gabriella.
Saw that, yeah, thank you that you came tonight. So I think that since we kind of digressed on that one and I got a correction on it, I don't think I have any other questions
okay.
now because I had a whole slew based if that was the information.
Yeah. Okay, Nancy, you're next.
Two questions. Do we ever look at turnover in comparison to other cities?
Yes.
And how do we, that'll be three
That's
now.
That's fine.
How do we fare?
Good, yeah, I mean, it's average. We're not in any extremes. We're seeing, you know, the job market's really good right now, so opportunities are out there, and turnover is still about 7.5%.
Can we qualify that real quick between non-police officer and police officer?
Yes and no. We're actually right on average with public sector turnover. We're a little bit better than private sector. The private sector generally does have higher turnover in many areas and government has higher tenure. The police department is one of the emerging areas where there's a lot of movement right now for a lot of reasons, whether they're leaving to go work for another city or just leaving the profession or retiring. There's a lot of variables around that, so it's hard to pinpoint one specific reason why ours might be different than the city of Westminster's or vice versa. Right.
And then my other question was, do people have greater expectations for employees in the public sector than the private? You know, in terms of providing good service and with a smile and...
Sure. We have those expectations of our employees. It's hard to answer that question between public and private. I'm sure there's just as many private sector employers out there that expect that as well. But yeah, that's one of our, you know, kind of guiding principles in establishing our pay and benefits, and the philosophy in general dictates that, you know, we want to get great people who care, who exceed expectations, who provide exceptional service and deliver results. So that's what drives us, and the reason why we set the pay and benefits as we do, to attract and then hopefully retain them. But that's a big question. I don't know a direct answer for you.
I just want to make a comment. Since I've been on City Council, I have not met one employee that I thought was, you know, a negative representative for the city. I mean, I think we have a wonderful group of employees, and I think that there's a reason for that. I think that when you feel appreciated, whether it's through pay, benefits, extras, whatever it is, I really do think it makes a difference. I think more people should have our philosophy, to tell you the truth, because I think we'd have better workers if we did.
I agree. Thank you.
Amen to that one. David Jones?
I'll make one comment, and then I have a question that may not be, it may be out of the scope for tonight, and I apologize.
We'll strike you down if you try to go beyond the scope.
But from a private
perspective, we've kept this really tight today.
Yes, we have. from the private sector, one of the, just to answer your question, I think excellence in any organization, whether a city or, you know, an organization like mine, excellence is key to our success. So here's my question. And it gets to the reserving of funds for future claims. How does the city, for our health benefits, how do we reserve those funds? And what's the process by which we're insuring? Is there a stop loss in place? And again, if this is not for tonight, that's fine.
Yes, we have a process. Yes, we have stop loss. Yes, we're very conservative in our budgeting. We are striving to achieve a level of funding in our reserve that would be 23% of total claims, total cost. We're not quite there yet because we're still new, but we are building it and building healthy reserves.
And by when will we get to 23%? What's the projected?
That's always a good question.
Yeah.
So ultimately, we were hoping by the end of 5 years. We're 3 years through our self-funded kickoff. And we sit today about 17%, 18%, depending on how the year ends up. And so we're hoping to add 10% per year of overall claims, which for us would be between $500,000 and $600,000. And if we achieve that, then we would stop once we hit there.
And what's our stop loss? Last question.
$175,000.
Oh, okay.
Per claim.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Bob?
So we might not be prepared to talk about this tonight, but sure. I think we need to put it on the radar, and it's around the police compensation. Mm-hmm. I saw the list of where we compare at maximum salary ranges on that table within the comprehensive report you guys gave us. Mm-hmm. And I've seen that before, and this is the struggle I have with being so much further down. We have a philosophy that we want bachelor degree officers, and there's a quality of life and a quality of performance that's expected from having that degree. Mm-hmm. But I feel that if we require that degree, we need to compensate for that degree. And right now you see all the police departments above don't require it but pay more. So then the question becomes is, do we need that degree? Could associate's degree work? Could maybe no degree work? Because the issues I think we're having around the churn in the police department is it's competitive. One, not very many people are coming into the market. Police, it's a hard job. It's not a glamorous job like it used to be. It's very tough on these individuals. So if you're putting out a net and you're trying to get bachelor degree police officers, the net is very, very small. So we need to really think about what is our approach to keep our staffing levels up. And, you know, is the bachelor / associates or no degree a true requirement that we value? And if we value it, we need to pay for it. Because I think that's part of our churn issue. There's other departments that are offering 10% more they're making here to go somewhere else. I'd be interested in the exit data. You know, these officers are working from call to call to call and a little short-staffed, and I think it's burning them out, and they can go somewhere else where there's maybe a lot more officers and it's not burnt out. So I believe we need to put some focus on what that philosophy is, and then we need to agree as a council what we believe what that philosophy should be in and come to an agreement if we should pay or not pay for having bachelor degrees.
You're right. That's a discussion that we will
yeah,
want to
yeah,
have.
That's why I said we just need to put it out there.
I think we need more information.
Agreed.
That's
yep.
And really the, you know, frankly, you know, I, my sense is sometimes you got younger officers who leave Arvada because it's a little too calm out here, which is pretty darn good from my perspective. And some of those officers will go to Denver or Aurora and then come back to Arvada because they've discovered that the grass really wasn't greener over there. So, you know, there's a lot of factors that weigh into it, and there's a lot of discussion. I, for one, really value having the degree requirement, and I think it's part of the reason why we've been so successful in not having issues in Arvada that some of our surrounding communities have. And then that does raise the discussion of, should there be other compensation because of that or not? And that's a conversation we ought to have.
Yeah, so. And I just want to add that I think that the chief has explained to me the management style of this staff, which is top-notch, which would tell me maybe the degree isn't warranted if the management structure is in place to properly manage as explained. So I just want to make sure we have a thorough understanding, because I know when they threw up a number for sergeants and commanders, your guys' mouths dropped. But I also think that's maybe even low pay. So,
well, that number included equipment vehicles,
cars,
and all that. So that's what threw.
Yeah, no, I get that. So I know the chief's not here, no one's here, but we do need to, I think we really need to come to head on that conversation, because I think that we need to make sure that the police officers are staffed and not have such high churn.
Can I make one point?
Of course you can.
In reference to that chart that you referred to on page 4, whenever we rank something like this, it does show where we are in relation to the other cities. But if you look at the numbers, we're very much chasing each other in terms of the annual salary. We're 1 to 2% apart from each other most of the time, and we're reacting each year. And it's just a common thing that all cities
do.
No,
I get that. The question becomes is how many of our officers are in a 4-year bachelor degree debt?
Right.
And these aren't.
And
we're paying for them or not. I mean, that's the question.
Mm-hmm.
We should be at the top in this case. If it's Lakewood and us that require bachelor degrees in the entire state of Colorado, mm-hmm. then we should be at the top of this if we have that 4-year requirement. There's only one other police department only needs associate, that's Pueblo. All the other police departments in the state of Colorado don't require it.
Right.
So
if you're just looking at pay, that's an excellent perspective, but that's when some of the benefits also come into play as far as the other things that our VAT officers experience here that they may not get in other organizations, and that's why that total comp look at the philosophy is really important too. We can only chase pay so far, but we can do some creative things with benefits.
Yeah, and pay is just one part of it. I've heard complaints about the retirement plans. So we need a comprehensive review of how these officers are being compensated.
I agree.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And we will have that conversation. Very good. I don't see any other lights on. Thank you for an excellent presentation.
Thank you.
Mr. McGough, you have 2.5 minutes. No, I'm kidding.
Okay, thank you, Mayor and members of council. You'll note that I do not have a PowerPoint presentation, but I will be going over a policy that we have reviewed a couple of times over the last few months in draft form, and I'll go over it quickly this evening for our mutual benefit and for those who are in attendance at the meeting. As a city council, we have the obligation and have carried out the practice of evaluating our 3 appointees each year. The 3 appointees, of course, are the city manager, the city attorney, and our presiding municipal judge. Over time, we've had a system of evaluating the appointees, which has consisted of listing out certain factors and then individually evaluating our appointees against those particular factors. The factors being different for each of the 3 appointees. Over the last few years, it's been voiced at the end of each of the evaluation periods that we've not been particularly happy with the evaluation process. the issues have been that we've had a mathematical scoring system on a 5-point scale, and each of us on the council would bring our own criteria to the evaluation process so that we did not have consistency in scores, so sometimes it was hard to evaluate what's the overall meaning of the score, the total evaluation score. A second thing was that we've had the, when we've done those evaluations, we've done them independently, each by ourselves, rather than having some simultaneous input by the council members. Accordingly, the policy that we have before us would have no mathematical scoring, would provide for simultaneous input by city council members, and that there would be an attempt to reach consensus on the evaluation rather than averaging some numerical scores. Another factor is that in the process that's being proposed, the council appointees would respond to specific inquiries, areas of inquiry that we might have about their job and job performance, rather than the past practice of the appointees preparing very long narratives in the hopes that they would hit on the points that we would consider most valuable.
Did you hear that, Judge Cook?
I wasn't paying attention.
That's good.
thank you, Judge. After last year, there was the discussion and the consensus that the process was not one that we were really fond of, and I was asked to work with Mr. Daly to come up with a policy that might change our approach. So when Mr. Daly and I met first, our first stop after conferring between the two of us was to talk with Linda Haley in the Human Resources Department and get some thoughts from her. And then we conferred and spent quite a bit of time and came up with several drafts. So here's what we have. What we want to do is, first of all, we'll kick off the process each year. The city clerk will do that and establish the date, and that has been put on the calendar, and that's June 26, I believe, is the date for the evaluations. So approximately 45 days before that, we will ask the council appointees to prepare a short statement, not longer than 2 pages, to talk about the significant issues that they've addressed in the past year and what they expect to address in the next year. And since the organizational development program, mission, vision, and values, has been a significant initiative, and that it depends upon the leadership of these three appointees, we will be asking them to address those areas specifically in the very short summary document. So that starts it out at about 45 days ahead of time. Another 10 days, so approximately 35 days prior to that, we will, and I have forgotten to mention, rather than our conducting a session ourselves, the proposal is to employ a facilitator, an outside person who is skilled in this area, to lead us in a discussion of the evaluation. A couple reasons for that. First, an outside facilitator can be somewhat objective in leading our discussion. And secondly, there's a fair amount of work that goes into leading the discussion and preparing a summary afterwards, staying in communication with the three appointees, staying in communication with the 7 council members, preparing the summaries, and meeting the deadlines. In the past, that task has fallen to either the mayor or the mayor pro tem, and for the most part, it has fallen to the mayor pro tem, and it has meant some added burden for the mayor pro tem at a time that might be not, you know, it may add a special burden to that person's workload.
That's why the mayor's always passed it to the mayor.
Right, the mayor has never volunteered to take on that task, in my experience. It may have happened in the past, but not since I've been on the council. So we have the facilitator. So then about 30 days before, well, first of all, 35 days, the facilitator will receive those summaries and will send those to the, will forward the written summaries prepared by the council appointees along with the evaluation factors and the previous job performance evaluation to the city council. So we'll get their statement and a list of some factors, and I'll talk about those. Then, in about 30 days, the council will meet an executive session without the staff present to discuss the performance of the three council members. So basically, what I envision and what the policy envisions is this is a discussion to say, of the appointees, what do we wish to commend the appointees for? What do we think their major accomplishments have been? What do we want to say positive about them? Secondly, do we have some things that, some areas of job performance that we wish them to either address that we think have not been, that are not up to our standard? And we can also ask at that point that we would like to have some additional information, either from the appointee or from some other area of the organization. So we get, during that discussion, the attempt will be, and I believe we can, reach consensus in identifying the strengths as well as any areas of needed job performance improvement for each of the council appointees. The reason I think we can reach consensus is that we're able to talk easily with each other. It's in a setting where we can exchange that information, and the benefit here of dealing with it in that way is that instead of sitting down by ourselves with a score sheet, we'll be able to discuss with each other and benefit from the discussion and the insights of each of the council members. So at that point, the facilitator will take the notes, write the summary, and prepare that. The facilitator will, number six on here, the facilitator will contact each of the council appointees separately and communicate the areas of job performance that city council wishes the council appointees to address. So, for example, there were some questions tonight related to the human resources presentation, for example, or economic development either. And we may say, as we evaluate the city manager, we'd like to have some additional information in these areas. So we can either ask that of the council appointee and say to the city manager, we think we'd like to have some additional information in this area to evaluate. So we can do that. We can also ask other members of the staff to weigh in on factors that we are concerned about. So then number seven, no later than 14 days prior to the job performance review meetings, so 14 days prior to June 26 this year, the facilitator will prepare a written summary evaluation statement for each of the council appointees and forward that to each of the council members. The summary will include a listing and narrative of the strengths and areas of needed job performance improvement identified in the executive session, and will also include the written responses to the areas of inquiry as submitted by the council appointees. At that point, the summaries will be forwarded to each council member and to the council appointees via email at least 5 days prior to that June 26 this year. And those performance evaluation summaries will provide the basis of the conversations with the council appointees when we call them in individually on June 26 and talk about their job performance. So we meet with them. Number nine, we meet with each of them in executive session to discuss the performance, and then we sign off on that summary and provide that as some written documentation to the appointees. So overall, that's the process to get away from a numerical scoring system, to have a discussion, to come to consensus about how we see our appointees. There are some attachments to the policy. The first is taken from the city charter, section 6.3, powers and duties of the city manager. This is just for reference. As we enter into a discussion, this might provide some basis for the discussion to say, well, what about this? What about that? It can help to hone our thinking as we go into that session. When we have behind that the performance factors for each of the three appointees. Those are not performance factors that we're going to weigh out and say, let's consider each one of those. Those, again, are just the factors that have been used in prior years, and they're only there to prompt some discussion, to give us some ideas about what we might discuss. So the attachments are simply there to help us generate discussion and perhaps to organize that. And by the way, those were added when we talked with the human resources specialist, June Ramos, who most of us do know. When we talked with her about conducting this session, she recommended strongly that we have at least these kinds of factors to give us points of discussion. So that overall is the process. I have talked with each of the three appointees and have not had strong objections to the process. It's intended to be, in a sense, a draft process, meaning that if we follow this process this year, I would like to and invite the council to really comment on this, as well as the appointees to comment on it. Perhaps it would be refined some more for next year. But the key factor that I would like to maintain this year and maintain from that point forward, unless we should come to some other conclusion, that is that we work on the evaluations to reach consensus on what the evaluation is. And that would happen through a discussion when we all have input at the same time. So that's the policy as we have it, as I would recommend it for this year, and ask Mr. Daly, as the kind of co-author of this, if there's anything you'd like to add at this point. Okay, be available for questions.
Great, Bob Fiver. Yeah.
Thank you.
First, thank you, Mark, and the staff who worked with you on this. I think this is a better approach. Now, the good part is this is my second year as Mayor Pro Tem, and I don't have to do the mayor's work like I did last year.
Yeah.
So, and I know you were the Mayor Pro Tem before, so I understand you understand the pain. The only thing that came up that I just remembered, and I forgot to ask you when you and I were talking, was there any discussion about a 360 review or any of that feedback? And what kind of information did you gather on that?
Well, yes, and by 360 review, do you want to define it in the way you're probably better at defining? I think I can still respond to it well, but I'd like you to define what you mean by the 360.
Maybe random employees of the city, peers, subordinates, just filling out a quick, anonymous survey on the individual.
Yeah. That was one of the points that we talked with Ms. Haley about as we started the process, to say, how might we do that? Because I had taken your thoughts about the 360 review. And we talked with her, and that was going to be one of the more difficult parts, is how do we randomize to get some responses? Do we stratify it so we get some from various levels, various departments? How might that be structured? And after that discussion, it was our conclusion that we would get caught up in all that statistics and trying to figure out, is this truly random and what meaning can we attach to it if somebody says something positive about one of the appointees or on the other hand says something negative? What value might we give that? And so, we did have that discussion, but we just couldn't figure out a process for doing that.
That makes sense. I think it'd be hard to normalize it.
That was the problem, but we did take a look at that.
If I might just jump in just very briefly, if you look at number four, the last sentence of number four, as Councilmember McGough remembers, it says City Council may also direct the facilitator to seek further input from designated individuals within the administrative staff concerning the actions of the council appointees with respect to organizational development. In the discussion that we had, as Councilmember McGough will recall, was that certainly one of the administrative staff members that might be contacted would be the HR director, because the HR director is very aware of what's going on with organizational development, which is the vision, mission, values, and is also aware of any personnel type issues that the various departments might have, especially those directed by the council appointees. And so I think that there still is the possibility for the council to have that discussion with the facilitator and try to identify individuals within the administrative staff to get information from. So that, I think that's still, I don't think it's totally closed out that you couldn't do that. I think you can have that discussion when you meet with the facilitator and then talk about who the facilitator's recommending. The other point I wanted to make just very briefly is the interesting thing about Councilmember McGough's selection, or certainly the council's selection ultimately, of June Ramos for this, is that June Ramos has not only led the organizational development as the outside consultant for the city for the last year or so, she has facilitated a number of other entities, including CML and that sort of thing. But in addition to all those things, she's also served as the management coach for each of the three council appointees. And so she has, I think, in her own mind, her own insights into the management structure and the way in which the three council appointees function in that particular regard. And I think the council will find that extremely beneficial when you're meeting with the facilitator in executive session.
I might add too that she was very intrigued by this type of process. As a management consultant, she thought this was a good direction to go, and she's ready to work with us on this and any refinements that we want to make in the future. So,
David Jones.
Bob asked my question, but I just wanted to thank Mark again for all your hard work on this. I think this is going to be a much better process this first go around, and I'm sure that we'll have, you know, maybe tweaks and twists, but I really appreciate the work that you've done over the last year to get us to this point. So thank you.
Thank you. You're welcome.
John.
So I'm going to be the contrarian like usual.
Oh, come on.
Just a couple small points. Within this policy, the reference for, you know, how things have referenced the mission, vision, and values, I'm not so sure how valuable I find that. I guess I find that valuable now in today's time frame. But 5 years from now or 6 years from now, that may very well be different. And I know these policies can change. A very small point. That doesn't really mean much. I have a bigger problem, though, with this policy requiring a facilitated discussion, and particularly a little bit of, as Mr. Daly was just talking about, the qualifications and qualities of June Ramos. It seems to me a little bit inbred when we've got the management coach who's coaching us on evaluating her clients, if you would, on performance evaluations, and to me that just strikes me as a little bit uncomfortable. And I, certainly this is all new and way outside of my world, so I'm willing to try it anyway. And I know this has been a whole lot of work, but I don't know that I need coaching in helping me evaluate our direct reports or even facilitation of that. And so I guess I would just throw that out there, that part gives me a little bit of uncomfortableness, and as well as, you know, we within city government are a little bit bad about performing studies on everything and hiring consultants to do everything. And in this particular case, again, I'm more than willing to try it. It's not a huge deal, but within this policy, that's the thing I have the biggest trouble with.
If I might just quickly respond to that, because I think that there was some discussion about that particular issue. First of all, I think the idea of a facilitator came up because I think that the view was that, for instance, if the council was meeting as a group without a facilitator, basically the mayor would act as the de facto facilitator.
Or the mayor pro tem.
Or the mayor pro tem would act as the as the de facto facilitator. And in acting in that role, I think that there was some concern that, you know, they ought to be able to just get back and say this is what I think of the three council appointees without having to worry about making sure that everybody's gets input. But the other thing is, truly, this is a facilitator. I don't think the view here would be that the facilitator is either managing the process. I think council is basically making all of the statements, and the facilitator is simply facilitating the discussion and then going off and making contact with the council appointees instead of having the council members, an individual member, for instance, do that. It's the facilitator that's doing that so that truly when the consensus occurs, the communication goes from the facilitator to the council appointees, and then the information also goes back to the council. But council is always 100% in control of what happens with the evaluation process. The facilitator truly is there just to facilitate what is happening.
Yeah, I guess, you know, I'm more than willing to try it. Maybe it's the right thing. I think it's hard when you have the seven of us sitting in a room with a management consultant professional who's also coached, through different duties, but coached our direct reports and have them truly just be a facilitator. Maybe that's possible, but I don't know. It strikes me as uncomfortable, and so I just wanted to make sure I brought it up. Again, I'm more than willing to try it, but I don't have great comfort with just that part of it. The rest of this, the process, and I commend Mr. McGough for all the work and Mr. Daly in putting this together. The rest of this process, I think, is spot on. I really, really, really like it. It's only the required facilitation part of it.
Yeah, if I could just respond to that quickly, just to reemphasize what Mr. Daly said. Yeah, the real reason for that outside facilitator is so that the mayor pro tem, in this case, can fully participate in the discussion without being the one who's taking the notes. And not the one who has to write the summary, not the one who has to adhere to a deadline or a timeline for doing all the things. I do believe that this person will not be working as a management consultant, will not be directing, but will simply be facilitating the meeting. If that should turn out to be wrong, then we have really guessed wrongly about the person we have. But I think we're going to be able to have somebody who will just simply lead the discussion, but then take it from there and manage that timeline and all the tasks that have to be done.
Bob?
That's the only reason.
Yeah, Mark,
that's the only reason for it. Because we did discuss at great length of just having the mayor lead the discussion. If the mayor leads the discussion, who takes the notes? Who writes the summary? You know, that was our problem.
Well, that's what I was going to say. Yeah. Because I asked the same question. I thought, well, why can't we just do it in our own circle and so forth? And then sitting there thinking, I'm going to have to be taking notes on all the conversation and then try to summarize it in a professional summary. Then I would have been short the opportunity to interact in the conversation because I'd be more worried about writing the notes. So
yeah,
that's when I asked. I was just going to give you the feedback when I asked about it because I was the one who's going to have to do it the first round.
Well, I heard so. Judge Cook was a good writer. Maybe he could take notes.
No, Judge Cook, we're doing comment cards from everyone that goes to the court system. That's how we're doing yours.
So if I may, first of all, I don't think I would delegate the facilitation role to any one of you.
Right.
Being the control freak that I am, but I would certainly have one of you be the scribe. And I do value the ability to be able to step back from running the meeting, leading the meeting, and having a facilitator do that. I like June Ramos. I think she's been incredible for our organization. I struggle with developing a policy around a specific person as the facilitator. And so, I don't know that I want to make that commitment tonight that's who we would be using. And she, I'm more than willing to try using her, but I don't think going forward that, it's that set facilitator.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
I agree.
So.
That's not part and parcel.
Right.
Can I ask you, Mayor, do you think that one area that might be sticky, do you think that maybe the mayor should be the one giving the feedback at that first time versus a facilitator, or do you see value in the facilitator being the middle person, the conduit?
I feel like if the facilitator would put the information together, it probably ought to be conveyed by the mayor.
Mayor,
yes,
okay.
If that's not clear here, that's certainly the intention, because the meeting we would have with the appointees, that facilitator will not be there.
But the initial
by that time, we have the document that we've had several days in advance that we can take a look at, and if we need to tweak that, we can. But by the time we get to the meeting, we have a statement prepared by the facilitator, but presented by us. The facilitator would not be in that meeting.
But we're talking about the step before that, after the initial meeting, and that what you're talking about?
Which,
number is that?
It might be, well, six. It's where the facilitator's interacting with the appointees as our communication on what the topics are and so forth. Should that be the facilitator? I feel like we're kind of a little removed from that.
Yeah.
That maybe that should just say the whoever we appoint in that statement, which would be, in this case, the mayor.
Well, again, we could take that. That's not the proposal here, and I would not recommend it, but basically we're saying we've got our meeting, and now we've got our emissary to take the information, to forward the information to the appointees. And if the facilitator is good, does a great job, we're going to have a good statement and one that we have agreed upon. And then she, in this case, she would be conveying that. But that's a matter of expediency and efficiency rather than trying to move us out of the process at all.
Well, the good part with policy, or this type of accounts policy, is if it doesn't work, we can change it. So
and it's specifically intended to be, although it's written up in a policy format, it's really intended to be draft in the sense that I hope shortly after the process, just like we did last year, to say, what do we think about it?
What
That's when people said, we don't like our current process very much. Let's do something different. And I hope we'll do the same thing this year so that it can change. But certainly, this one is intended to be draft in that sense.
Very good. Okay, everybody okay with moving forward? And I assume this will be brought to us? Or
it'll be brought back in the form of a resolution on March 6th. Yeah.
Very good. Good work. Good work. Yeah, it's been, and Mr. Howard and I can testify to how much frustration we've had over the years with the evaluation process, and it's just brutal. It's very tough. It's brutal,
yeah.
And I appreciate the work you've all put in. This seems rather unique to me, and I'm glad we're trying it.
We'll give it a whirl.
Okay. Mr. Devin, anything else?
Just want to remind the council, we have a holiday next Monday.
Oh, nice.
And then you have boards and commission interviews on February the 27th. Our next workshop will not be until March the 27th. We've got park ranger program and development review process on the agenda for that workshop.
Very good. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Have a good evening.